So shall we
Very few
start?
people have answered. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yeah, you go on, Yogita.
Okay. Very few people have answered the questions which sir has posted in Google Classroom. Because of the time issue or what else? Would like to know just.
Yeah, I will say time issue from my side.
Okay. Okay, so we'll start the session. I'll hand over the session to Manish sir. If you have a query regarding clustering or classification or the machine learning applications again, if you have any doubt, so you can ask. Sir will take first your queries and then he will start with the association. Over to Manish sir.
Thank you, Yogita, and namaste to all of you. I think it's better, no, like no good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, because its time zone are different, so it makes some conflicts. So namaste
right.
is a good namaste is a good exactly. idea, and I think Vijay has started with namaste that day, so it clicked me.
That's your namaste is becoming the new greetings for the world.
Yes, yes.
Right, even if people see each other, no shake hands anymore. It's
yes,
all namaste.
Yes. Yeah, it's all namaste. And yeah, the meaning of that one is also very beautiful. No, they say it's a combination of namaha te, so that the soul which you have in you. So I'm going to that soul. So both
correct,
are
correct, correct.
Going to each other.
Right. That's true.
Yeah. All right. So if you have any comment on what we have discussed up till now, if you have any query, any doubt, then just we'll have a few minutes for that, and then otherwise we will go ahead. As Yogita was telling, if you just go on the Google Classroom, make sure that you go through all the resources, because in clustering also I have posted some very good resources, like one OpenRefine software, and it's a application of Google, how application of clustering, how clustering is applied on refining data. Okay, so it's a very good product, actually developed by Google first, and now it is in open source domain. So this OpenRefine, so that link is also there on Google Classroom. So many other resources are also there on Google Classroom. You just make sure that you are reading it, so it will help you to give more insight of this topic. Means whatever I am talking, you will get some other perspectives of that topics also. So it's better you just go through it. And this Google Classroom, we will delete after say 15 days. So make sure that you download or whatever material you have, so you copy it on your own machine also. Okay. All right, so any question, any suggestion, any query, any doubt, we'll have that one for a few minutes first. Shriya is not there today. All right. So let's move to another unsupervised learning application. It's unsupervised. As yesterday we were talking about that the beauty of unsupervised learning is that we are exploring it. So we have large amount of data nowadays, means even it's in terabytes. One of my student works for a company where they deal with terabyte of data, and the terabyte of data, they want to process it as early as possible. It's all around, all about shipments of goods through the big ships, through the vessels. So here we have lots of data, and we want to explore that data. We want to find out patterns from that data, which we otherwise could not get. So yesterday we talked about clustering, So clustering is also one technique that explores the data and try to give you some genuine groups that you might be interested in. And then from that groups, you may come up or may you think of some good decision making strategies or some activities for retaining the customers, for increasing the business. So in this way, it's exploring the data. So another one very good application of unsupervised learning that we are going to discuss today, and it has great applications, large applications, and it is being used in industry. It's association mining. Like, we want to find out whether any two events, whether any two objects are associated with each other or not. Okay, say the obvious example which I have discussed with you since first day is the transactions that took place in big shop, in super shops, okay, in retail shops. So we have say, for example, 50,000 transactions every day because it's a chain of supermarket shops, and every day 50,000 transactions. On each transaction, we have on an average 5 products are purchased, and a list of, say, for example, 5,000 different products that we maintain in that super shop. So it's a big data that is generated every day. And as a super shop owner, I want to know which products goes together. So that's my problem. Like, if I know that product X and product Y goes together, then we can make some strategy. Like these schemes generally have, if you take this, then you get a particular product Y on 50% of price. So how these schemes are generated actually? Because they know that there is some association between these. Some schemes go based on, they know that this particular product Z is not moving, is not going off the shelf. I mean, there is no demand for this one. So let us decrease its price. So that are the strategies. Once you know the data, once you know how the data, how the movement of the products is. So therefore, here the simple thing is, like, we want to know the association between products. It's obvious one, which I was telling you, but now there are a lot of applications of it. Like, say, for example, large number of news atoms we can consider are generated every day, because we know lots of media, every media will come up with some different news, and then that leads goes on, and then people start trailing it, and then every second you get new breaking news. So these are the number of news. So can we find out which news goes together? And say, for example, if particular news happens today, then there is some association between news. One news comes, and after 10 days, another news come. So like, there is any association between these two. This happens, like people are applying it in hospital also. Like, say, for example, symptoms, and then the recurring symptoms comes after 5 days. So there is an association between symptom one and symptom two with a time gap of 5 days. And if it happens, then this leads to this one. So large data is available. We have to find out some patterns from this. And therefore, this unsupervised learning helps us. We don't know what we are going to find. The data itself come up with something innovative, something novel. There is a popular example of association mining. When someone will talk association mining, he will give this example. And as this example was very innovative, and people try to find out such innovative patterns. It was in North America. They found, when they analyzed the data, somehow they found that people who are buying beer are also buying diapers. So these two products are actually not in our wild imagination will go together. Like someone will buy a diaper or someone will buy a beer and he will go to look for diaper. Oh, where is diaper? And then he will buy the diapers also. So we know what our associations are, like milk and sugar, bread and cake, milk and bread. So these are the obvious association that we know. But beer and diaper, so they are like something which was a shock to everyone. Everyone was shocked. Oh, how it is possible. But the data was telling it. Yeah, like 100 people, those who purchase beer, 90% of those purchase diaper also. So 90 times they goes together. 90 times out of 100, then 90 times they goes together. So the data is telling the fact, and it's like a gem out of the data, came out of data. It's a pattern that we never thought of. And then therefore the social scientists come ahead and they found the reasoning behind it, why it happens, why people who buy beer also buy diaper. So they created some logic behind it. But that comes after. Here, as we are inducing, like that rule comes first and then the reasoning comes. The data has come up with some innovative rule. So therefore, we want to see this association mining. I will show you 2-3 slides and then we will directly go to the practical so that we can use it. Let me share my screen with you. And I have a lot of things open over here. Okay, so this is I'm sharing my screen and this is the presentation. We're talking about what is association rule mining. And an example over here, it's from hospital patient domain, healthcare domain. And we all know that there is a cholesterol in our body. It's and that can be measured. And there are two types of cholesterol. One is LDL and one is HDL. And then they say one is good cholesterol and other is bad cholesterol. One is good cholesterol and one is bad cholesterol. So this LDL is a bad cholesterol that we should not have that high. And HDL is a good cholesterol. So these are the terms that are coined and then these are the medical jargons. Nowadays they say it doesn't make any difference. Cholesterol is not bad. Nowadays they are saying cholesterol is not bad, but initially it was said that there is a two types of cholesterol, bad cholesterol and good cholesterol. So the bad cholesterol is LDL and good cholesterol is HDL. So if the bad cholesterol is less, then it's okay. The good cholesterol is high, it's okay. But if it's reverse, like here, people who have high LDL, high bad cholesterol, and low good cholesterol, they are at higher risk of heart failure. Fine. So here, the conditions, patients are there, and we have how this rule have come forward. So we have the conditions we have mentioned. So it's high LDL, low LDL, high BMI, heart failure. And when we screened this particular data set, when we run association mining, we found that which two atoms, which two symptoms goes together, and because of these two symptoms, which third symptoms occurs, as I was telling, is there any recurrent activities or recurrent symptoms that comes because of the earlier symptoms. So if you have high LDL and low HDL, then there are chances that it will be a heart failure. So many times these three out of these five, these three symptoms will go together. So it is in first, it is in second, it is in this fourth, and it is in fifth. So out of five, four times we have noticed this particular phenomena or these three atoms on this transaction. So this can be considered as transactions. And in one transaction, these symptoms goes together. So in this way, we want to find out frequent patterns. The patterns that goes together, the atom set that goes together, when we talk about in the perspective of super shock, we will call it as an atom set, that two atom set, three atom set, four atom set. Means if that four atoms goes together, then we call it as four atom set. two atoms goes together, we will call it as two atom set. Means two atoms are associated with each other. Okay, so we want to find out frequent patterns, association, correlation, or casual structure among the set of transactions. And this is the terminology market basket analysis, MBA, they call it as. Same group of atoms brought together and placed together in the cart. Okay, it has an application in healthcare also. Goal is to find atoms for which joint probability of occurrence is. I will see an example. So let's go ahead. It's a diagrammatically we will see. Say we have two atoms that goes together, X and Y. So X is purchased this many time and Y is purchased this many times. So these two, the joint area where both are meeting each other. So that is where the both atoms are purchased. So we want the find out how many times the atoms goes together. Means say, for example, if we have 1000 number of transactions, 1000 number of transaction, and we say that two atoms, say for example, water bottle, any bottle, water bottle, drinking water bottle, and say for example, pen, they goes together. So the person who purchased water bottle also purchased pen, for example. So in order to say that they are frequent, means they goes frequently together, they goes together frequently. So we need to find out, because the term frequent is subjective. The term frequent is subjective. Like I will say out of 1000, if they go 300 times together, means in 300 transactions, if I found pen as well as water bottle, then I will say they are frequent, because out of 1000 transactions, 300 transactions are there where water bottle and pen are together. So I will say they are frequent enough, because my definition of frequency is, okay, 30% is good enough. But for someone, say Minal will say, no, it's not okay. 30% is not okay. I will say they are frequent only if out of 1000, 400 transactions, in 400 transactions, they are purchased together. It means that this frequency, when you will say that the pattern is frequent, because it's a pattern, I'm talking about a pattern, that water bottle and pen are purchased together. It's a pattern. It's a two atom set. I'm talking about a two atom set. There are two atoms, therefore I'm saying it's a two atom set. And they are brought together. So it's a pattern I'm talking about. And this pattern is frequent or not, it depends on individual person. So it's a subjective, as I said. So therefore, in order to define it, we will use a parameter or an input parameter. Like, as I said, Minal will say that I want support of 40%. I will say they are frequent only if they occur 40 times together. I will say it's okay for me. I will say they are frequent if they occur 30% of time. Someone will say, like Mangesh will say, 20% is enough, because there are large number of transactions. So even if they occur 20 times, I will say they are frequent. So therefore, this particular parameter is there. So if support is one parameter that we will consider, this confidence I will tell later on. If two atoms or three atoms or four atoms, because we go on, it's not necessary that we all always find only two atoms that goes together. There may be different five atoms that goes together. That count also will be there. So we just don't want to say that it's only up to two atoms. So atoms that goes together, we will say they are frequent only if they are occurring in more numbers than this particular support that we have given. If I say support is 10%, it means that out of 1000, in 100 transactions, those atoms should occur together. if I say support is 80%, 80% support I want, then out of 1,000 transaction, in at least 8,000 transaction, they should go together. Means Atom water bottle should also be purchased and Atom pen also should be purchased. Okay. So this is how, what actually we want to find out. Okay. Once we identify those patterns that are frequent enough. Once they, we know they are frequent enough, then we will find out another one, like how the rules are formed. The rules will be in this format. It's like here, an implication expression of the form. X implies Y. It will be in the form of X implies Y. Left hand implies right hand side. So the atoms in the left hand side implies that the atoms at the right hand side will also be purchased. Okay. And as I have said, this particular association rule mining is also maturing. This particular study or research is also being maturing. Large people are into it, and therefore more and more innovations are coming. Here we are talking about a situation where both atoms are purchased together at the same time, because it's a one transaction. We are talking about in one transaction. They are in one transaction. So today we have purchased. So whatever transactions are there are 2 days. Okay. So they are purchased together. So X implies Y. X implies Y. X may be two atoms, like here we have X was here. X is this one, high LDL, low LDL implies Y. Okay. High LDL, low LDL implies Y. So X may be one or two atom set or three atom set, and right may be again one or two atom set. Okay. So here once we find out frequent atom set, then we will go for this association rules. So these association rules are important, and these association rules are novel. These association rules are very data driven, means they comes from the data. Even your domain expert might not have that particular idea. Oh, is it happening? Oh, it's surprising for me. So this is how he or she might react. Okay. So X implies Y. This is a rule that we are interested in, and this X implies Y we will be able to obtain only if we found X and Y are frequent, or only when X and Y are frequent. We found X and Y frequent, it doesn't mean that X implies Y. It depends on this confidence parameter. Okay. It depends on confidence parameter. I will explain that one. So we just try to understand first that we want to find out frequent pattern, frequent atom set, those goes together out of large number of transactions. Actually, this is a very complex problem. The processing is very complex for this. It's because, as I said, 50,000 number of transaction daily. On each and every transaction, on an average, there are 5 to 6 atoms purchased. Somewhere it is purchased 50, more than 50 atoms are also purchased. Somewhere only 1 or 2 atoms are purchased. So on an average, 5 to 6 atoms are purchased, and every day 50,000. And the number of atoms that we have, the number of atoms that we have in the shop, are in thousands again. 10,000 number of atoms or 5,000 number of different atoms will be there. Each atom has their own code. Okay, so this is how we have to look. And finding out patterns, those atoms which goes together, was very highly computing processing, high computational processing was required. But one of our fellow Indian, his name is Rakesh Agrawal, he came up with a very genuine algorithm, very innovative and very beautiful algorithm. That's what we are going to use. The algorithm is called as a priori algorithm. Yeah, the a priori algorithm. I will not go into the details of a priori, but this is the one of the most cited paper in the history of computer science. And we are proud that an Indian has developed this one, Rakesh Agrawal. And this algorithm has made it simplified. It has reduced lot of processing time, and online we are able to get the association. Otherwise, it was very difficult, because as I said, it's very large amount of processing power was required. So this is how it goes on. So let us move on to an example so that I will be able to explain it. I have a okay. This is a I have one created one data set where I have around 700 transactions, and the atoms are named numbered as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 up to I think 15. 1 to 15. 15 atoms are there. Different 15 atoms are there. So as I said, this is how my transactions will look like. This is my data set. Okay. And sometime I have 3 and 3, 6 atoms purchased. Sometime less atoms are purchased. 5 atoms are purchased. Here only 5 atoms are purchased. Sometimes it will be like 4 atoms are purchased. Somewhere it will be 3 atoms are purchased. Somewhere 2 atoms are purchased. So it depends. So it's not every time there will be 6 atoms are purchased. The maximum is 6 on an one the transaction that has maximum amount of atoms purchased is 6 here in this data set. It is for this data set. But there are transactions where there is only 1 atom is purchased. There are transactions where there are only 2 atoms are purchased, 3 atoms are purchased. So they are also there. Now if I want to, Weka also supports association mining. In Weka also there is a implementation of a priori algorithm. But when I want to represent this into ARFF file format, attribute relation file format, we all know that in case of Weka, we have to in one line, the number of different atoms should be same, because we know that this corresponds to attribute. So first attribute is 2 times, second attribute 10, like that one it will be. But here some transactions, say for example this 10th transaction, there are only 2 atoms. Okay, so in that case it will be difficult to represent. Sometimes it is 6, sometimes it is 3, so it will be difficult to represent. But in Weka they represent it in a different format, and that is very difficult to understand and to comprehend. Therefore we will use a more simple representation. It's natural one, like this one. This is more natural also. So we will use this representation, and we will use SPMF, the other software which I have asked you to download. Using SPMF we'll see the a priori algorithm. The SPMF is also a platform where large number of algorithms are implemented. Means even clustering algorithms are also there, and association mining algorithms are there. Variations of association mining and variations of clustering are also available. Even it's for sequence mining, means like we are talking about the transactions, but sometimes in sequence we have to mine that today what happened, then tomorrow what happening, after 5 days what is happening, and after 10 days what is happening. Then it forms a sequence. So this SPMF is initially developed for mining patterns from this sequence data set, but we will use it for association mining. So I hope you understand, and if you have any question, any query, then you just shoot it out. Otherwise I will show you Weka also. Is it making sense to you, like what I'm talking, or any question?
For this SPMF, do we need a Java install?
No, JRE, if you have JRE environment, that's all you want.
Oh, JRE, I think I don't have, so it's giving me error.
Okay, I will show you just here. Say, let us open a file data set. Vika has a data set of for association mining also. So I will show you that one. Okay, so we have this supermarket ARFF. Supermarket ARFF. I open it, and if I see this supermarket, and you see like this supermarket is a relationship name. There are 4,627 instances. It means that 4,627 transactions will be there. We will be talking about 4,627 transactions. Attributes are 217 attributes. Okay, so what these 217 attributes correspond, these are the attributes here, 217 attributes. What these attributes are, actually those many atoms, different atoms, unique atoms that you have, all atoms becomes attributes. Okay, so we have wrapping, we have dried vegetable, we have packed canned soup, we have soft drinks. This becomes your attributes. So this particular table, if I see, it looks like this. Okay, so this is how we have this. Like here, all attributes that dried vegetable, packed canned soup, all are on the columns. And on first transaction, if you purchased whatever atom you have purchased, you will write T in that column. Otherwise, all columns are left blank. All columns are left blank. So preparing the ARFF file from the transaction, it's difficult. It's difficult in case of Weka, because the Weka want it in ARFF format. That's why they have developed, they have made it like this one. But it's not easy for us to comprehend this. So for example, I show you that in the text file also. Easy for you. And that's why we have used another one. Just okay. So it's a ARFF file of that supermarket. I opened it in text file. So it's a relation name is supermarket, and attributes contain all different atoms that we have, unique atoms that are purchased, baking needs, coupons, and canned fruit, jams. Only 217 atoms they have taken into consideration, different 217. And this is how the data looks. Look, on first transaction, only few atoms out of 217, only few atoms are purchased, maybe 4, 5, 6, 7, or maybe 10 in tens. So this is wherever there is a T, that atom is purchased by on the first transaction, and all other are marked as question marks, means they are not purchased. So it's a very difficult representation to comprehend for a common man, for us. So therefore, we will avoid this and we will use a more natural one. That's why we'll shift on to SPMM. But I will just show you the result. It means it is already there. So we will just use this one. And then I will go, I have opened the file. So this file is opened. We have 216 atoms and they have created one more attribute called as total. That attribute. So we have information of that total is low or high. So this is how the data is available. And then we go to associate. So we want to do a priori. So this a priori algorithm is there. Again, as we all know, if we click on this white area or text pad, there is parameters that we can set. Okay. So as I said, I talked about support to you, that the frequent pattern, when you will say that it is frequent. So that is determined by the support, that how many times the atoms should go together to be called as frequent. Okay, so that was support. But another one was there, that was confidence, that every frequent atom set will not be leading to a association rule, that will depend on confidence. There are some another measures also, lift, leverage and conviction. I will explain confidence, and if you are interested more, then you can just read more about other parameters also. So here are some parameters you can fine tune, and then I will just say start. It will process and then will give me the association rules. Okay, and the association rules which we obtain, let us see what we obtain. It's processing. You can see the bird is moving left, right, and it is ready now. The associations here that we obtain are mentioned here. What is the association rule? So we are, it is in the form of X implies Y. So here this arrow is there. So we have a left hand side and a right hand side. So this is an arrow. So we have, it's in the form of left implies right. Okay, left implies right. Okay, so here it says, and what is the support that we have given? Let me see the support. The upper bound of minimum support is 1. Okay, so it's like percentage they have given. 0.1 means 10%. Okay, so 10% transactions, if they follow the rule, they are frequent if 10 in total 4600 something transactions are there. If it's more than 466, then it will be frequent atom set. Okay, here we come with a rule that is obvious. All these rules are very obvious, but let us see this one. Left hand side implies right hand side. So what it says, if you purchase biscuit and frozen foods and fruits, then it implies that you are going to purchase bread and cake also. Okay, so biscuits, frozen foods and fruits, and bread and cake, they are frequent atoms. And if in 788 transactions, this left hand side is occurring, out of the 788 transaction, 723 times this right hand side atom is also occurring. Okay, so therefore in common there are 723 transactions where both are occurring. There are 723 transactions where both are occurring in where means left hand side atoms and right hand side atoms occur together. So this is very, these all rules are very obvious, not new to us. Biscuits implies party snack foods. This is the fifth one. Party snack foods, fruits, implies bread and cake. Okay, so if you take party, there is a party, then party snack you are purchasing, then obviously you are going to purchase bread and cake. Okay, here we have said that we want 10 best rules found. That's that might be in the here we have mentioned that 10. Yeah, number of rules we have mentioned 10. If we say number of rules 30, and if there are 30 rules available, then it will show you, it will show us that 30 rules. I will say start again. So those were the best 10 rules that were applied, that we have obtained. But as we have said that we want 30 rules, so it will take a little bit more processing time to obtain the remaining one also. So we have 30 association rules now. As I was telling you that the processing is very exhaustive for this type of problem. So here, if your support is less, then obviously it will again take much more time. And here you see minimum support we have said 10%. So you will not find any count which is less than 10%. How much it is? 462, which is less than 462, because total number of transactions are 4,627. So 10% of that is 462 or 463. So all transactions must have occurred more than 463 times, more than that. If it is less than that, then it will not occur. This is 463 times occurred. So we will not find anything which is less, smaller than that, because it's 10% we have considered. If we have considered it 15%, so those who are occurring here will not occur there. So the lower bound of minimum support is 0.1. So if I change it to 0.2, so it means that those transactions which are occurring 20% of time, means at least 800 times, those only will occur here. So I will show you that. Okay, so these are transactions 463 such as which will be more than 900 times, that will only will occur, because we have changed it. So I will say start, and it will be only few transactions will come. Okay, so look, as I changed the support to 20%, so there are no atoms that are brought together in 20% of transaction. In 20% of transaction, like 20% of transactions means how much it will be? 900 and something. Such as, yeah, it will be 920. So there are no transactions that occur together. Yeah, here it is. Minimum support is 0.20.2, means 925 instances. Minimum support is 0.2, means 925 instances. So there are no transactions that occur together 0.925 times. There might be someone, but those who will again satisfy this constraint, another constraint is also there, where it is 0.9 confidence. I will explain that one. So it does it make sense? If you have any question, if you don't understand, then you just ask me, tell me, so that we can just go ahead. Okay, just recap it.
For the rolls, is there a reason that you did 30 rolls? Or was it just random?
These all rolls are correspond to transactions. These all rolls correspond to transactions. Like we have 4,000 transactions. I have showed it in here also, text pad also. So these are this is how the atoms are purchased. But the atoms are purchased in this manner, means actually the text pad should look like, they are purchased like here, like this. First transaction atom numbers are purchased in this way, but in ARFF they are represented in this manner. Okay, and those atoms are taken, and then based on that these rules are formed. I hope I answered your question. If it is not, then you just ask me again.
I think I understood it now. Thank you.
Okay. All right. So that's where we will leave Weka. And then we'll move to our own SPMF, where it will be, I will explain confidence also, and you can apply association rules over there also. So let me close this. So this is a SPMF. Works in this fashion. Say this is a SPMF interface, very simple. And it has a very powerful documentation also. Here, when you install it, just copy it and install it. It's a set of library, as I have mentioned. Lot of algorithms are there, association rule mining algorithms, which are related with association rule mining. Algorithms related with clusterings are clubbed here. So lot of algorithms are there. Yesterday we talked about K-means, the popular one, but DBSCAN is also there. We have seen the demonstration of DBSCAN. Others are also there. Then dataset tools are also available. So it's a set of different algorithms. Lot of algorithms are there. All right. So we will talk about association mining. So we are interested in association mining, a priori association rule. So if you click on it, and then you go to the documentation, it has a very good documentation. It has explained how actually the rules are obtained. We'll go to that documentation so that we can understand it. So here it says that if you want to do the association rule, then they says that you choose this algorithm, FP growth association rule algorithm, and they have given an input file also. They have an input file, and then they say that you can choose the output here and then use run the algorithm. This is a minimum support they have mentioned, 50%, means out of, say for example, we are talking about 10 transaction, then at least in 5 transaction, those atoms should be purchased together. Okay, and the atom sets, the data set is here. So we have, in an example, say 6 transactions are there, and these are the atoms that are purchased on that transaction. And then we will see which are frequent atoms. So we will run this in this fashion, FP growth association rule, and this context igb.txt as an input. Okay, I will show you that context igb.txt also to you, and then accordingly we will see. And when I say support is 50%, means at least three times the atoms should be purchased together, at least three times, because here 1 and 2 purchased in one transaction, here 1 and 2 are not there, in the second transaction 1 is not there, so we will not count that one. But in the third transaction again 1 and 2 is purchased, so the count becomes 2. Again in the fourth transaction there is 1 and 2 purchased, so the count becomes 3. In the fifth transaction again 1 and 2 is purchased, so my count becomes 4. In the sixth transaction 1 and 2 are not there. So 1 and 2 are frequent because they are purchased 4 times here. Out of 6, 4 times they are purchased together. So therefore I will say they are frequent enough, okay, because they got purchased 4 times, and my minimum support is 50%. But if I say out of 6, I will say they are frequent if they occur 5 times, okay, then in that case 1 and 2 is not frequent atom set. 1 and 2 will not be frequent atom set because it occurs only four times, and my minimum support is 5 out of 6. Okay, so in that case it will not be a frequent atom set. Fine. So we'll see how you obtain this frequent atom set. I have added few atoms and few transactions also there. So let us go with this example, and then I will elaborate it again once the rules are obtained. So we'll go with this FP growth association rules. Choose the input file. The input file is there in the SPMF test data, as I said. SPMF test data also there. And then context IGB, let us use that context IGB. Text file. Context IGB text file. And for output, I will use the output file over here. There is the output file. These are all text files. These all are text files. Okay. And then we will here, we will tell the minimum support and minimum confidence what we want. Here it is. We will mention that how much we want. Say for example, we'll take 0.6. And then we will, here there are two ways of seeing the output. Either you can see it in text editor or you can see it in pattern viewer. So it's again a tabular format in which it will show. And if you run this algorithm, I've taken another algorithm. It's FP growth association rules. Fine. And the minimum support I take 0.5. Either you can give in percentage or in this 0.5 or 50%. So these two parameters we need, input parameters, support and confidence. And then if I run the algorithm, here I see the result. I will open the text file also here so that we can compare the result. SPMF test data and context RGBA. I have added few more transactions over there. So we have 8 transactions total, 8 transactions together we have. I have added few more transactions actually in initial file to understand it more. So now based using this, we will try to understand the result. And then along with, I will also explain the confidence. To you, the major confidence to you. All right, so this is how we have. And as I said, the support is 0.50. Support is 0.50. So therefore, as there are eight transaction, and at least 4 times they should be purchased together. So therefore, 8 and 10, if I take the atom set 8 and 10, I want to check whether atom 8 and atom 10 are frequent or not. So they are not frequent because 8 and 10 occurs only in one transaction. So therefore, the 8 and 10 will not come into this frequent patterns even. It will not, it is not even frequent pattern, okay? If it is not frequent pattern, then obviously it will not going to come in the association rule, okay? If it is frequent pattern and if it follows the another constraint, that is of confidence, then it will be as it will be formed as a association rule. Okay. So now this 2 implies 1 is support is 5. Let us see 2 implies 1 means 2 and 1 occur 5 times, as we have already counted it down 4 times at the time, but later on I have added one more transaction here. So we'll count it down 1 and 2 atom in first transaction, in third transaction, in fourth transaction, in fifth transaction, and in the seventh transaction also. So it has a support of 5, okay? So 2 and 1 together occurs in 5 transaction. So the minimum support was 50%. So it occurs 4 times. So therefore 2 and 1 as well as 1 and 2 both are frequent pattern, okay? Now, when you say it's frequent pattern, now we see about the confidence. Let us talk about confidence, this measure, different confidence, different measure, another measure. The rule 2 implies 1 has a confidence of 0.7, and the rule 1 implies 2 means whenever you purchase 1, you also purchase 2. The confidence is 1, and whenever you purchase 2, you purchase 1, the confidence is 0.7. So why it happens so? Because both are occurring 5 times, that's true. 1 and 2 are there present in 5 transactions. But additionally, this 2 is purchased in another transactions, like 2 is purchased in 7 transactions. 2 is purchased in 7 transactions. So the atom 2 is purchased 7 times. Out of that, 5 times we purchase 1 also. So it is 5 upon 7. The confidence is, the rule confidence is 5/7, because 2 is purchased in additional transactions also. The left hand side atoms are purchased in another transactions also. So atom 2 is purchased 7 times. Out of that 7, 5 times we purchase 1. So therefore the transaction, the confidence in this rule is 5/7. But if you come in the second rule, 1 implies 2. So what happens? 1 and 2 are purchased together in 5 transactions, and 1 is purchased in only 5 transactions. So all 5 transactions where 1 is purchased, 2 is also purchased. So therefore the confidence is 5/5. So the total number of transactions where both atoms are present, divided by the total number of transactions where only left atoms are present, gives us confidence. Okay. So for example, for this, 4 implies 1. So how many times 4 and 1 are there? So 1 first transaction, second transaction 1 and 4 is there, means third transaction we have, so the count is 2. Then fifth transaction have 1 and 4, the count becomes 3. Then the seventh transaction have 1 and 4, so therefore the count becomes 4. So therefore 4 and 1 are frequent atom because their count is 4. So minimum support is 0.5 there. That's why they are occurring here. And what about the confidence? The confidence is 4 implies 1. So how many times 4 occurs? 4 occurs 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 times. So it is 4/5. So that's why it is 0.8. Okay. So here in this way, we are able to calculate the support and confidence. And if I change my confidence to 0.8, suppose my confidence is currently 60%. If I change it to 80%, then this rule, 2 implies 1 will not come, because it is a frequent pattern, but its confidence is not 80%. Okay. So if I change my confidence to 80%, then obviously the rule, where the confidence is less than 8% will not occur. So 2 implies 1 will not occur, 2 implies 4 will not occur, and 2 implies 5 will not occur. Okay. So let us do it again. So for example, where I will change my confidence to 0.8 and I run the algorithm. And as I said, those rules are not appearing where the confidence is less than 0.8. Only those rules where the confidence is 0.8 and greater, only those rules will occur. And here, this, look at this particular rule, 241. So what does it mean? Or even this one, the opposite of it, left side 1 and right side 1, 2, 4. So it means that it's a 3 atom set. It means these 3 atoms, 1, 2 and 4, this goes together. 1, 2, 4, this goes together in 4 transaction. Out of 8 transaction, in 4 transaction, 1, 2, 4 goes together. 1, 2, 4 means it's a 3 atom that goes together. 1, 2, 4, 1, 2, 4. This is in the 5th transaction also, and in the 7th transaction also. So 1, 3, 5, 7. 4 times they goes together. 1, 2, 4. So this is how, once you have 3 atom set, then you prepare the rule in combination. 1 implies 2nd and 3rd. 2nd implies 1st and 3rd. 3rd implies 1 and 2. So it's all combination. You can see here. 2, 4 implies 1. 1, 4 implies 2. 1, 2 implies 4. And then you check the confidence for it. If the confidence is greater than the minimum value that we have given, then it will become a rule. Otherwise, it will not be the rule. Okay. So in this way, the support and confidence will work. 1, 2, 5 is also a frequent item set. So we have a 3 item set is frequent. Frequent item set count is 14. Here it is mentioning. So we can see that here. Here it gives the result that how many times how many frequent items are obtained. Transaction count from database is 8. The memory is given how much required and this one, and the number of association rules are generated 18, and frequent item set count 14 frequent item set are obtained. So this item sets are obtained in this manner. This is how actually it works. The a priori algorithm works in this fashion, that this is your original data set. This is original data set. Then we obtain one item set, how many times it occurs. So it occurs 2 times, it occurs 3 times, it occurs 3 times, and D occurred 1 times. So we will prune it. It is not occurring the minimum support, because our minimum support is here maybe 2. So minimum support is 0.5, means out of 4, 2 times it should occur. So it is not occurring 2 times. So therefore we will not consider it. So we are pruning it. We call it as prune. So this Rakesh Agrawal has given algorithm. He told that we can prune and then we can join. So that's the combination of pruning and joining. So here we have pruned it. We will not use D anymore. So the frequent item set we have obtained, ABCE is a frequent item set, because they occur at least 2 times, because our minimum support was 0.5. They occurs at least 2 times, and then we will join. Then we will make all combinations AB, AC, AE, BC, BE, and then again we will find out how many times they occur. So AB occur 1 times, AE occur 1 time, so we'll not consider them. Then AC, BC, and accordingly we go on finding out 3 frequent item set 2, frequent item set 3, frequent item 4, like that. Here in Weka, I close it. In Weka, they have you can see those how many frequent item sets are obtained. They have given all different frequent item set that are how many frequent 1 item set, 2 item set obtained, that are shown in Weka also. Supermarket, and then associate, and then start. So look here, size of set of large item set L1, there are 44, it's a big one because 217 items are there, different items. So large item set L1 is 44, means there are 44 frequent item set 1, which are at least occurring 0.1, 10% of time, because your minimum support is 10. Here there are 2 item set, there are 382 item set, 910 3 item set, 633 frequent 4 item set, 105 frequent 5 item set. That's why it is 3 items are coming at the left hand side and 1 item is coming at the right hand side, that all combination will come there. And there is a 6 item frequent item 6 frequent 6 item set also available, one only. So that's how we get association mining done using a priori algorithm. So if it's okay, then we just will try on another data set. The data set that we have developed, it's again as shown it in the text. Any question, any queries, if you want to comment anything on it. Okay, great. You don't have to comment even today. Do you understand it?
Yeah. I mean, you're kind of understanding both the software. So, yeah, I'm good so far. Thanks.
Yeah. I'm expecting some feedback so that I can go ahead. All right. So, for example, this is another one. I have generated it randomly from 1 to 15 random numbers I have generated, and then I have prepared this data set. Again, it's again a transaction. So it's a simple transaction, 720 transactions. So we can just go ahead and check it with the whether which atoms are goes together, and we can find out the patterns. Here, it's difficult for us to find out the patterns by looking at it. Okay. And as I have said, I have made it using some Excel and thing. So sometimes what happened is look at this transaction. I randomly have put values in the cell. So 7, 7, 7 comes again. Whereas in case of transaction, the 7 will come only once. So it will not be like again and again. So it will be like this one. So some flaws are there in this data. But anyhow, we can just go ahead and experiment with it. Here again, 8 and 8 come again and again. So anyway, so this type of transactions, if you are available with, then you can go ahead and we can work on SPMM. So instead of this context IGB, if I give this particular file, let us see what happens. If someone mic is on, can you just mute it? Thank you. Okay. So I have another file with me, but now when you say 0.5 support and confidence 0.8, let it be, we'll try with this one. Then let us see what happens. We have around 720 transactions. Let me see. So 0.5. 0.5 means 360. So it's big number that out of 720 transactions, the atoms do it goes 320 times together is a very big number. Generally, they go for 10% or even less than that percent in the super shop. So let us try with this one. So let me run this algorithm. No frequent atoms are found because it's very big number, as I said. This is what they have mentioned. The transaction count from the database is 720. Frequent atom set count is 0. Okay. So it's very big. Even 10% will be big for that. 720, 72 times. Let us see if we found something. No. Even 72 atom transactions will not have the same number count. So maybe 0.36 times, maybe. No. So 7 we have found. As I said, there is a flaw in the data itself. So there we are getting such type of results. So this 10, 10, 1 is a frequent atom set because there are 14 transactions. There are 14 transactions out of 720 transactions where the atoms 10, 10, 1 are coming together in 14 transactions, they are purchased together. This confidence is wrong because, as I said, we have wrong inputs here, wrong data we have, because 10, 10 same atoms are there, so therefore their count will be more. So that's why, otherwise the confidence will never go more than one, will not go more than one. So just to make understand, so this atom 1477 atoms occur 12 times. So this is implies two, that is the support of it. So in this way, if we have more appropriate data, then we can try with this association mining. I was talking with one bank manager, and then he said, okay, is it possible to, we have some saving scheme accounts. We have some saving scheme accounts, and we have numbered it. I will number them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 atom, 8. And I have customers. Then I have customers, say 500 customers, and then I will say customer one purchased saving account 1, 3, 5. So I will have it in the form of transactions. And can you find out any association between the fixed deposit saving scheme accounts? So it was a application in the banking domain. It was an application in banking domain. So that data is also available, so that we can apply it in any domain. Okay, so here, that's all about this association mining. If you have any question, then we can have that. Otherwise, have an activity also.
I have a couple questions. Is it like how we decide which algorithm we have to use in SPMS? Is there any, again, similar to the Weka, we just find out which works best, or is there any factor that we can use when choosing the algorithm?
The algorithms are grouped and their major category is mentioned. Say, for example, these all are association mining rules. There are some clustering algorithms. So they are grouped together. The algorithms are grouped under major category. So if you want to do some sequence mining, time series mining, so they are grouped together. So once you know what you want to do, say for example, sequence rule mining you have to do, many algorithms are given. And under this, you need to know, because sequential rule mining, these number of algorithms are there, each algorithm does something different. That's why a separate algorithm is there. We have to find out, means when you are applying, that what are the pros or what are the advantages of ER miner over rule growth or CM rules. So once we know that and what actually we want, accordingly we can use that particular algorithm. But you can go and explore any algorithm here now. So for example, CM dev algorithm. So there is a documentation available. It will tell you this algorithm, go for this particular text file and then see the result. And it is also mentioned, as I said, it's a sequence mining. Sequence mining means it's a sequence. So what it does actually does, these are sequence. These are not transactions now. These are not transactions. These are sequences. So here, this is transaction in one sequence. There are many transactions. So one, the person come and purchased only one item one day, but on some another day after this day he comes another day, and then at that time he purchased three items together. Okay, so this is how the sequence of that particular customer, how this is how he purchased. This is a purchasing pattern of that particular customer. Okay, S1 is a customer. This is a purchasing pattern. S2 is another customer. His purchasing pattern is like this. He comes on first one day and purchase two items, 1 and 4. Then another after few days, he comes and purchase 3 and 2, 3, like this one. So these are the sequences. You see the difference between transaction database and sequence database. So if you want to find out in the sequence data set, then you will have to use the sequential data mining algorithm. So you need to know what actually you want to find. And once you know that one, you want to find out sequential rules, then large number of algorithms are given in sequential mining rule there, then you can apply those with, you can see the documentation also.
Okay, and like I have that one example at FC Growth Association rules. We ran that and we got like small window with a couple of patterns.
Okay.
So is that the only data we get from this and we use it? Like basically, once the user gets this data, how he's going to use it? Or how is there any graph generation or report generation, or it's just going to give us pattern and then user have to decide how to use this pattern?
Yeah, from large atom set, means we have, say for example, here in case of Weka sample, we have around 217 different atoms. Out of that 217 atoms, we not knowing which two or three atom or four atoms goes together. That pattern is identified by this algorithm, association rule mining algorithm. That pattern is obtained, frequent pattern. And based on the confidence, the rules are defined. So once you get the frequent atom list, then you decide that what confidence you are looking for, and then you find out the rules, association rules. And once the association rules, because here it is not plotted, like it is not a graph. So you, the pattern is in front of you, and then you decide once you know the pattern, that what you are going to do with the pattern. It's like frequent pattern, but sometimes you will try to find out the atoms that are not sold at all. So you want to find out those atoms which are on the shelf for a long time. So that type of pattern can also be obtained here. Okay. So it's a negative association mining also we can find out once you are okay with it.
Okay, yeah, thank you.
Anyone else want to comment, want to say something about it? All right then. I just want to share some on this classroom. Actually, I'm getting a sound, buzzing sound. If someone's mic is on, can you just mute it? Okay, great. Here on the classroom, we have shared the recording also. We have recorded the session, so the recording is also there. I just want to share some answers so that it is also clear to you. Some of you have given very good answers. I appreciate that. I'll just go through all the answers, questions and answers so that you just have that particular aspect also. Out of many machine learning algorithm, which application? That's a question that I have asked, that how, which machine learning application is fascinating to you? So got some very good answers. I will share those also answers also with the classroom. Very good answers in the medical domain. How the algorithm or the application of medical domain fascinates me is the answer of one candidate. Like in the healthcare, how much calories I have burned, how much calories I should eat, and it recommends me something. So that particular application is very well explained. I think it is by Mangesh. And I will share that answer to you also. That was a very good answer and very innovative also. This one was another question I have asked, like, what would you suggest so that our class will be intelligent in the sense of machine learning aspect that we are talking? And very good answers are also obtained. Like here we can do some personalization. This personalization in learning is also an application is of machine learning. And one of my students have completed his doctoral work, doctoral degree. He obtained his doctoral degree. Like we are giving content, personalized content we should give. Like every student has her own learning style. Like some student like to see visual content rather than reading content, the text content. Some students are good when they do experiments rather than just listening. Some are good in listening, some are good when they see the picture. So visual, verbal, sequential, global, active, perspective, like these are the active, passive. So these are the learning style. And based on this learning style, if we give the content to the students, then they will understand it more. Therefore, same topic, say for example, a topic of how to sort, how to sort numbers. We want to sort numbers, like 10 numbers are given to you and then you arrange them in ascending order. So that's a problem of sorting. So the same problem of sorting should be given to different students in a different manner that will suit to his or her learning style. So therefore, the person who is active, who has active learning style, we should give some active task to him so that he will do on his own. One who has passive, so we will demonstrate him in using presentation. Okay, we'll not ask him to do that. So he's not good in activity. So in this way, personalized content delivery, personalized content delivery, that's a big area that people are researchers are working on, and it will be the future. In future, you will get, like in India, we have Byju's and other unacademies also there. They are giving online content to the student, and now in future they will say, okay, we will deliver you the same. One of our participant also given that particular suggestion that we can give different content to the participant based on how they are solving the assignments. So this type of intelligence we are expecting. So that's a good answer that I have got. In the context of machine learning, the question. In the context of machine learning, what is mean by feature? We are talking from the first day, we are talking about features. So the feature is not color of an object, not weight, but what do we mean by feature? Feature means some answer of this one also, a specific characteristics. So it's true that any specific characteristics is a feature, but that should be measurable. If it is not measurable, then we cannot use it in machine learning. So a specific characteristic that can be measured is a more appropriate answer for this one. So when we talk feature in the context of machine learning, it is a specific characteristics of that particular object that can be measured. So one example is, like we have discussed, like if you want to decide, if you want to develop a classifier, whether the food atom that you have in your hand is fresh or not fresh, okay? Then what you can do is, like, you will take a picture and then have a large number of features. But the most prominent or most significant feature is like the smell of that one. So if you cannot measure the smell, then we cannot incorporate that feature into our classifier. So therefore, it should be measurable one. So therefore, the answer is more, if you write it measurable, then it is more appropriate. In classifier, I have said that you try to develop a classifier for a gender classifier. So what might be the list of features so that you can make a gender classification, gender classifier, whether it is male or female. We have one example. We have a demo Scratch program and we use that one. But if it is what was the question? Yeah, we have a data set of 1,000 objects, say for example, and I opted for 20-fold cross validation, 20-fold. So each fold will be of 1,000 upon 20. So each fold will contain 50 different objects, 50 objects or 50 instances. How many objects will be used for training and how many would be used for testing in each run respectively? So we want how many will be used for training and how much will be used for testing. So each fold is of 50. So this is going to run for 20 times. And each time 950 will be used for testing and 950 will be used for training. So this is a correct answer. 50 and 950 is not. 950 is for training and 50 for testing. That's the answer. Then we go back. We're talking about classification. This is confusion matrix. Yeah, this is also a question that is good, and it's a question that is little tricky. And the answers are wrong, therefore I will elaborate it. If I have a data set that have five numeric attributes, means they are all integer values or some real values, and 5,000 odd instances are there, can I use J48 or any other classification algorithm to classify it? So the answer is yes, but the answer which you mentioned, Sandeep and Mangesh has given, is yes, but actually it's no. Because when you say that I want to classify, you must have at least one attribute which is nominal. So all five attributes you have are numeric. So you cannot classify because you don't have any nominal attribute. So otherwise it's okay. It means whatever you mentioned is okay. But at least you should have one nominal attribute. So that's a tricky question it was. And in clustering, as I said, there are I have posted some very good resources. You just go through those resources. One very good application of OpenRefine I have already discussed with you. The objective of unsupervised learning. What is the objective? Choose the most suitable. Unsupervised learning is used for forming groups containing same number of instances. So that is not true because you form the groups, but the groups may be of different number of instances. So what is the objective of unsupervised learning? So to discover novel patterns from the data, even if you cluster it, so it's a pattern actually that these particular customer or these particular objects are having similar characteristics. So that's why they are grouped together. So we are actually discovering novel patterns from the data. And then, these are again two very good resources to understand clustering and association mining. I have not asked you a question, but let me tell you. Can you think an application related to association mining? Maybe related to. Yeah, can you think of an application related to automobile industry where association mining can be used? So it was an explanation that if you can think of it, then you can just, it's a sort of something that you can ponder upon later on. And it is an MCQ. If an association rule Item 5 implies item 8 has support of 76% and confidence of 85%. I will ask this question so that you can just go and try this one, because 76% of support means at least 76% of time both items 5 and item 8 should be there in the should present out of 1,000, so it will be 760. But the confidence, you have to make some calculations, so you do it. And then what we have, Veka, this one question, what Weka does not support. Weka does not support, Weka supports classification as well as clustering also. We have seen that one yesterday. Weka supports clustering. Weka supports text processing also. Means like if you can give a text one and then that text processing is also supported. But Weka does not support image editing. Means it's not image editing software, okay? Data pre-processing it obviously supports. And some real life examples also I have given. So you just go ahead with this one. Please explore the real life application as I was talking. And the sentiment analysis, I will share this link also to you. So this is all I have. A few resources also I have. Maybe I have not explored, I have not shown to you. So I will just go through it and then I will show it. And then later on, Yogita will take charge. So let me show you some resources which I might have not shared with you. List of all the resources. Reinforcement learning, we couldn't find time to complete it, but let us have a demo of reinforcement learning, how actually it works. As explained in the first day or even in that video, reinforcement learning is used for decision making. And if you are going on wrong path, then your points will be deduced. So for example, this particular robot is started from here and it's a learning phase. So this is the target, and if it is going on the right track, then we will increase this, we'll give some rewards. If it goes wrong side, then we will punish him. So that's how it goes. So if I increase its speed, I have increased its speed. So you can see this is a learning one. It is trying to reach to the destination, and it is exploring each and every path that is available for that robo or for that particular agent. We call it as agent also. So these are the agents and they are traveling. Hopefully it reached there. May increase it. So it is exploring every path. And reinforcement. Ultimately, it will reach to the destination because we are rewarding it and we are punishing it, and somehow it will reach to the destination. Explore something and then it will reach. And once it is reached, it's a training model, and then it will follow the best path every time. Once it is trained, it will immediately reach to the destination. Okay, so I've just done this one and follow the best path. So look here, it is following the best path now. Reach to the destination in 7 moves. So once it is trained, this is how reinforcement works. It's for agent training. Agents are trained like this one. The agent may be robo or maybe anything. It's reinforcement. K-means clustering demo, Yogita has shown it to you. We have DB scan also, Yogita shown you to you. Classification demo, I have shown how well it classifies when it is SVM as compared to random forest. There are male classifier examples are also there. I will share this file to you so that you can go through it and apply it. I will show one because I have not come up with a NLP natural language, because a lot of people are working on all works that we have discussed is on what you say is database, means like a number of attributes are there and tabled one, means structured data. It was a structured data, but now unstructured data means like actual sentiment analysis. In the first day we discussed, so that type of application. I will show one demo of that one. NLTK. So it's a text processing, textprocessing.com. A lot of applications, NLTK demos, natural language toolkit. It is a natural language toolkit. Look here, analyze sentiment. I don't want to go and read all the review. I will ask computer or system that you read the review and tell me whether I should go yes or no. Okay. So this is what I want to analyze. So up to 50,000 of characters I can give here, and I will say analyze, and it will give me the result. So what it is give me the result in two ways, subjectivity and polarity. So whether it's positive or negative, this is what it is saying. It's positive, great movie, it's positive, 0.7. And polarity means it is not neutral, means subjectivity, and it's polar means I'm going to tell you something for sure. So it's telling me positive. Great movie, but I will add something like, but should have less fighting. It's good movie, but should have less fighting. So I have changed it. So let us look because I have reduced it, some negative words also I am talking, entering. So hopefully, yeah, look here, it's negative now. So in this way, it is the text is negative. I added some music. Is really awesome. So it is looking for some words which are positive or negative. And then I say analyze it again. So it has changed to positivity. Okay. So in this way, you can it will read and it will weight the terms and accord. So it is working on natural language. Okay. One of our participant has sent me a mail and asked like how we can work on the scraping, web scraping. So this lot of tools are available where we can use web scraping, and based once we have that particular bag of words, like we have continuous stream of words, these are continuous stream of words, and we don't know how many words will be there, because sometimes it will be less or it will be more. So this ARFF file type format will not work, because every time we don't know that there will be 10,000 words will be there. Sometimes it will have only 500 words will be there. Sometimes it will be 1,000 words will be there. Okay. So therefore, each word is considered to be an attribute here. Each word is considered to be an attribute. Because as you say that it was great movie, it was positive. But as soon as I said should have less fighting, so it has become negative. But I again added one word called as awesome, then it has become positive. It means that each word is an attribute, and that counts significantly. So in this way, large applications are coming up where they are working on text instead of structured data, unstructured data, and on that unstructured data this should be applied. So a lot of work is going on in NLP and AI hand in hand. So that's all from my side. If you have any query, any question, any comment, then we can have it. And otherwise, we just have some activity, maybe 5-minute activity that Yogita has planned. So if you have any question, then we'll have a quick round of that questions. Otherwise, handing over to Yogita.
Oh, Manish sir, this is
Yeah, Ashutosh.
Hi. No, I just want to add, like, somebody asked you a question about the screen scraping. So, like, in my day-to-day work, actually, we use a software called Instano, which is a AI automation software. So basically our need is like we work in the logistics and we go to the different shipping companies on their website and we automated like a human intelligence, like it will go to the website, it will stop there. It will also put the container number. It will also click after a few seconds and get the data and scrape the data and bring it back to our database. So just to
give
some example.
Yeah. Once you are able to scrape it and then bring it into structured manner, then you can again do a lot of things. But bringing it into structured manner is itself a challenge. And that's why sometimes this OpenRefine, which I have shared with you and I'm talking to you, it's prepared by Google. So Messy data, whatever Messy data that you have, it pre-process it, as well as they have given one video where they have from Wikidata, they have how you can collect it and you can structured it, because in Wikidata it's in text format, so that text data can be converted into tabular format, and once it is in tabular format you can apply any machine intelligence at all intelligence into it. Thank you, Ashutosh. What was the name of that particular software?
Instano. Yeah, INSTANOW.
Okay, Instano. Okay. Thank you. Okay, all right. Thank you for your cooperation. Thank you for your patience. Thank you for your late night. It is late night for you, some guys, and then you all attended it very positively, and you always encouraged us, both we and Yogita. Thank you from our side. And Yogita has one assignment, one activity. Over to Yogita.
Thank you, sir. What I have thought is that whatever you learned up till now, like say machine learning, then various techniques of machine learning, that is clustering, classification, and association mining. So I just wanted you people that whatever you have understood, so just try to represent diagrammatically. Means without you, with the help of any word, try to represent whatever you have understood by what actually the machine learning is, or what actually the classification task is, clustering is, or association. So try to draw it, and I'll give you 5 minutes time, or you can take 7 minutes time. So that draw it and you can present it. So we are interested to know how you draw it, or what you have understood, and how you represent it. So all the best for all of you. I guess all of you have understood what actually I am expecting. If not, then you can ask. All of you getting what activity I ask you people to do? Akash asked that you just draw it, what you understand by the machine learning. Means whenever, if I ask you what is machine learning, so you will try to answer with the help of words, you will go on writing. So I'm not expecting any text over there. I just want to represent it diagrammatically, just draw and diagram. You can include the characters or like say picture, whatever you have understood. So just draw it and share it.
Is it like a flowchart you're expecting, or is it a...
Yeah. It, by any means you can share. You can draw it in your paint also, or you can draw it on paper also, and just take a screenshot and you can show it to us. Whichever is convenient and suitable for you people. So any means is okay. I guess everybody is understood.
Yes.
Okay. As all of we know that the picture talk more than the words, so that kind of thing I just I'm expecting. I would like to give you an hint. In my presentation, on the first slide, I have used a picture that one robo was there and that lying down and reading a book. So that actually a machine learning means that picture I like. So that's why I kept it on my first slide of presentation. A very simple way is that how to share a picture is, if you have drawn it on a paper, so just simply turn on your video and hold the paper in front of your camera so that it could be visible for us. This is, I guess, the most simplest way, or else you can take a snapshot and you can later on upload it in Google Classroom even. I think, Ishan, it's clear to you now.
Let me see, Ishan.
Oh, sorry, my son's name pops up there.
Okay. I guess Ashutosh ji.
Yes.
Anika, you're done with the picture or yet to done?
I still need to finish.
Okay.
I have mine.
Okay. Akash. Okay. Akash.
Wait, do you need me to explain?
Okay, hold it little bit closer. Okay. Getting it. Machine learning as a picture. So you have drawn, I think a robo is there on the right hand side.
Yeah, okay, that's my stick figure. So okay. I have like a human head that with like codes in it and like machine chips. And from that, the robot analyze it and then it can do like, it can predict, improve and learn.
Wow, it's AI. Wonderful. It's Thank really you. A wonderful. Very nice.
Thank you.
Who else is done with the activity? Akash, have you joined the Google Classroom?
Yeah, but I haven't been able to finish everything. I'm working on it though.
Okay, you work on it. Can you just upload this picture on the Google Classroom? I'll post the question and then you upload it.
Okay, that's okay. I can do it.
Okay. Thank you.
I have my, I don't know if it is visible.
Yes, sir, please show.
I think it's not possible to show on the screen, but I will take a screenshot and put it on a Google Classroom. Basically, what I'm saying here is, showing here is there are big Excel or database tables. There are pictures, data, there are graphs, and it's difficult for a human to understand easily. So basically, next thing is machine learning or AI, and they do processing, learning, presenting in an easier, easy to understand form.
Okay, fine.
I think I have mine too, but it's pretty simple.
Okay, Anika.
Okay. So I just put machine learning and there like the different types, the three types. I didn't have anything for reinforcement learning, but I had classification for supervised learning and I had clustering and association. Those are the two like we worked on. I don't think we worked on any other ones for unsupervised. And then I just, I don't think I finished for association, but I did fraud detection. That's how you can use classification. And for clustering, I said the candlestick method that you were talking about yesterday for predicting stocks.
Okay.
Very good. Okay, all right. I think Yogita, we can ask all others to submit on the Google Classroom. You create a
Okay, fine, sir.
Yeah. So maybe rest them can submit online.
Yeah.
So all right. I think.
Okay. Then, sir, shall we conclude?
Yes.
Okay, you go ahead.
That's fine. Like we just want to get feedback from you. If you want to take something, because we have done, I mean, whatever we want to tell is already over. So if you can comment, if you want to give suggestion, if you want to give feedback, then also you are welcome. And as I said, we both, Yogita and me, are thank you to you all for arranging this. And especially thanks to Ashutosh and Vijay ji for arranging it, everything. Thank you all.
Thank you all.
Thank you, Manish and Yogita.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Satish. Thank you, Yogita. That was a really good learning for us. I'm totally from different field, but I got to learn a lot. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Manish sir. Thank you, Yogita madam.
Thank you.
Yeah, for especially like we are working with eye opener, because yeah, we never thought of the first time we saw this tool, and it's really very powerful actually. So thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am.
Miss, because like I will just give you example for our audience. Like when my company started using Instano, like we basically asked like Microsoft certification or Java or management certification, like cost is like just 1K, 2K, 3K, and they are not approving it. And actually for when we brought Instano on the board, the cost of training 1 week was 15 grand, and they approved it, and they trained me. So I was confused. Like I asked my manager, like, why you are spending so much? He said, like, for one website automation, we are paying them 5,000. So if you automate 4, we got our money back. So yeah, it's a really very powerful one. It's a future actually.
Mommy, will you please turn on your light?
Okay, so all right. So hopefully we will be in touch using Google Classroom for some days. And then maybe in a week or two, we will delete it. And then we will, we have one WhatsApp group also, that also we are going to delete it. So thank you all, as I said, Ashutosh and Vijay ji, for your cooperation and for your support.
Yeah, thank you, Manish.
Oh, Vijay ji, do you have a question?
Yeah, so I think you already said that. Sorry, I was pulled up into other conversation about Sunday's event. Thank you, all of you, for one, joining us, right? And two, really learning together. It's been a great, great experience. More specifically, Dr. Manish ji, we really owe you a lot. I think you're doing an amazing job to help the community out. We are helping each other by enhancing our knowledge by really helping each other out with the knowledge that you have, you're sharing with us, and we truly appreciate it. So on behalf of Shivaji Maharaj America Parivar SMAP Foundation, we are really thankful to everything you did for us. And then anyone else who would like to know more about SMAP, please let us know. Please join us. Our goal, as I mentioned in the first meeting, is literally network, connect good people, promote unity in wherever you are, whatever part of the world you are. Go back and help the community. And then finally, just literally building some leadership skills across all the youth that we have. So this was our first project, in the sense that Dr. Manish ji and Yogita ji gave their time to the volunteer cause, and the volunteer cause is to educate people. So that would be our fundraising type of initiative going forward. So as opposed to we contributing, asking people for funds, we'll probably request people to contribute by their knowledge and a skill that somebody might be really good at, leadership skills. So we can do a class on leadership, and then if anyone wants to donate as a part of that education that they got, that will be good help for us. Very creative new thing that we're trying. Yogitaji, truly appreciate your support as well. I know you are the backbone behind the scene, and we're very fortunate to have your support as well. So we'll do more of this. This is just beginning, as I mentioned, and it's been an incredible journey. It was an incredible learning, even for me personally. Today I was just a little distracted because of other event that we're planning on Sunday, continuously on the calls. But I try to attend all other days and learn something new, right? So my job, I require, I hire a lot of people with data science background, responsible for strategy and analytics for the company. So I also learned quite a bit from you, both of you. So thank you again. Truly appreciate everything that you did for us. And this is a long-term journey. We will be in touch. We will work together on many future initiatives.
Thank you. Thank you, Vijayji. So nice meeting you all. Hopefully we'll be in touch. Thank you all, and bye.
Thank you again. Bye, everyone.
Bye, everyone.